I'm going to call this meeting to order, please. This is the Board of Zoning Appeals for May 11th, 2016. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Danelle?
Here.
Perry?
Here.
Jacobs?
Yep.
Con?
Here.
Reyes?
Here.
Chris Pfeiffer is unavailable this evening. Also present is Denise Springer, planning and zoning official for the village.
Has everybody on the board had an opportunity to review the minutes of the December 2nd meeting?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Does anybody have a motion to approve the minutes?
I make a motion to approve.
Second.
Judy, do you want to roll that, or do you?
Oh, you can just raise.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Very good. We have one public hearing tonight. This is an application from Select Signs for Dayton Mailing Services at 888 Dayton Street. Ladies and gentlemen, I am in contract with Dayton Mailing, and I will have to recuse myself, so one of you all will have to take over.
Well, that was quick.
I've been saddled with this in the past, but I think we ought to spread it out. Who else would like to?
Well, Con, he makes good ones.
Yes, put it there.
He's all right.
Could you all adjust, well, you're switching now.
And he likes signs, so.
I like that, I like the gavel, is what I like.
We're okay.
We might be in trouble.
Could you all adjust your mics? Thanks.
He's already done that, you missed.
Yeah, I know.
And Ellis, yours is like way, there you go.
I'm going to confuse your YouTube viewers.
All right, so, I guess I'm going to ask if we could have a presentation for this application from the applicants. So I don't know which of you is.
I'll go first.
Okay.
Good evening, Ken Soward, Executive Vice President, Dayton Mailing Services. We have contracted with Select Signs to attempt to give some more definition to the building at 888 Dayton Street. As you know, the building, we bought the building, and we have several tenants also along with Dayton Mailing Service. One of the difficulties that we're having with the tenants, we did build a parking lot on the Dayton Street side for Dr. Grombeck's office. And all he has is a sign out there that is a piece of paper, plastic, whatever you want. So his clientele is having a very difficult time finding his office. The Kettering doctor's office also is, the only signage that they have is on the door and a plastic sign out by the Enon Street entrance. So what we've contracted them to do is do some design and see what we can do to alleviate that problem and give us some signage that we need for the business in a whole for Dayton Mailing Services, since we are the anchor of that building. Mm-hmm. And in that regard, I'll turn it over to Select Signs. Do you have some a presentation or drawings or something to show them?
He's actually passed those on to me.
Okay, go ahead. Right,
go ahead. Okay.
Yeah. If you have any questions, I'll answer mm-hmm. those also.
Thank you.
Do you want to show the
yeah, actually, those are in the packet. Just to kind of give you a little bit of overview of the situation at 888 Dayton Street, in the business and industrial districts, currently the sign code only allows two types of signs and three total signs. That's really problematic for this particular location because they actually have seven businesses in there right now. In my analysis of it, there are, let me go back to my, it's either 16 or 17. There's 20 different signs that are exempt from a permit. These are signs that are either directional, like a municipal type of sign, a seatbelt, fasten your seatbelt, an incidental type of sign, like a security alarm. And then we have what's called nameplate signs, which in nameplate signs are supposed to just really have the name of the business and are supposed to be on a wall. In the case of 888 Dayton Street, a lot of the walls are glass.
Mm-hmm.
So because window signs are not allowed in this particular district. Now, this is a PUD, but according to the zoning code, for each separate business that's in a PUD, you're to look at that business and what is it the closest to in an accepted use. And then, so if it's like a medical office, then it's probably like you would look at B2, where there are other medical offices, and you compare like that. So that being said, there's 8 different directional signs, 5 municipal signs, an incidental sign, 5 other nameplate signs, and an address sign. And the permitted signs, there's 1 wall sign, even though it's on glass, and 3 ground signs currently there. I've also put under there temporary, and the only reason that I put it under there is it kind of falls it doesn't really fall under not exempt from a permit, but then it doesn't completely fall under permitted. It's sort of, these are the signs that are like garage sale signs. So you know they're a temporary sign. That's Dr. Grombeck's there. That's the only thing he has to identify his business right now. And, you know, it's a temporary sign, but, you know, it's not something that is...
It's not substantial.
No, it's not substantial.
Mm-hmm.
So even if we would eliminate those, we're still dealing with 4. We're over by 1. Now, the sign, when they were doing the zoning code in 2013, it was a huge process because they completely updated the entire zoning code and looked at that. And sort of put on the back burner a little bit was... signs. And so the Planning Commission's charge over the last 3 months actually, was to review the sign code. And they have, they agreed on Monday night to the language in this particular area to say 3 types and 4 total signs. And they've gone on to say another sentence that will say, so they added, in the case of a multi-tenant building where the maximum number of permitted signs has been reached, 1 additional sign per tenant shall be permitted.
So it's X plus 1. So Denise, I'm sorry, can I just clarify for just a moment?
Sure.
We do not have this new planning commission, what the planning commission approved in our packet, because
no.
That just happened Monday night.
It just happened Monday night. And
okay.
It hasn't been approved by council yet.
It has not yet been approved by council.
And that's
okay.
Going to have to go through a first and second reading. It'd be too long for them to wait for that process. I mean,
mm-hmm.
We knew this was kind of coming up, but this could be another month or two.
I feel like this is something we had this problem last time we met. There was a council was going to act on this, and we were sort of ahead of this, but yeah. Okay.
Right. yeah, they acted on a whole bunch of stuff, but the signs is still, we've still been tweaking that. So I kind of feel like we need to even go beyond even what Select Signs is requesting here, because when Select Signs, if you approve them to have the ground sign at the shipping and receiving entrance on Dayton Street, they plan to put other other tenant names in there. But I feel like in the case of Dr. Grombeck, he needs to still be able to like have a wall sign or something that can be seen from Dayton Street, because
mm-hmm.
that's just not going to be enough. Just that. Like actually, if people, depending on if they're coming into town, they would have already passed his office to see that sign, even though the idea is for people to turn in there and then go into the parking lot. Okay.
Okay. Anything else that you want to add to that, Denise?
No, just that I think we were going to put these in the packet, these pictures, but there were so many of them. That we just decided to show it to you here. That, if you want to go through it super quick, that sign there, and correct me if I'm wrong, is actually going to, would be changed to what's in the packet. It's one of the designs.
So that's going to, that's now the cube?
The one that's at the corner of Dayton and Neiman, the next one. The one that, that one.
This one?
That one would be reconfigured. This one here, I understand it's going to be taken out, will be removed. Is that what you told me?
It will, it's subject to be removed.
One of the, that one, it just went through the view, is going to be taken out?
Potentially.
Oh, potentially, okay.
That's what I'm interpreting. And, you know, mainly probably being taken out because it's a ground sign and it's adding to what already is, we're needing a variance on.
Although they could probably fairly call it a sculpture.
Put some yarn on it.
Actually, my wife has seriously talked about that as using those as some type of artwork in front. And see how it looks. But generally, we would, the one on the corner is going to be replaced with a DMS ink sign.
With something that looks like.
This sign here was originally there with the 888 on it. Mm-hmm. We took the white panel off and had our business logos just put on that. The sign didn't change on that one. It was just the artwork changed on it.
It should be in the packet, yes.
So it's, that one's at the corner.
The corner of Dayton, yeah.
So this one,
will replace the 888.
Will replace the 888.
And then she wants to reuse the 888 somewhere else. But if we, you know, if we don't get the numbers up there, we'll have to remove that one totally in place of our other one.
Okay.
So we would like to use all of them because there was obviously a large amount of money used to make those. Mm-hmm. And, it still gives some kind of meaning to the building as 888.
As a threat.
That's where we stand with those two signs.
Okay, so Denise, that's what you, anything else for you to present? And so can I ask my colleagues here if there are any questions for Denise?
I guess I'm trying to get a crisp sense of what will eventually come to the floor for us being put to, to some sort of motion to be approved or not. I don't know that I have that yet. So I'm wondering, is that coming somewhere in the discussion or is that later? And are there going to be,
well, what
if is there a proposal that we're going to eventually have some reaction to?
For tonight, you're asking?
Yeah.
Okay, well, we just need a variance of at least one over possibly two if we're going to also allow to have a sign at Dr. Bronzak's location.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm just trying to keep it. We have a lot of sort of imagery and some concerns that I think I understand. But I'm just trying to understand also what is the sort of business before this body as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So, Ted, you want to come on up?
All right. My name is Ted Dunnell. I was the architect when the building was purchased by the Development Partnership out of California. And at that time, the building was turned into a multi-tenant building. And the intent was to brand the entire building as an image, which is where the 888 Dayton street sign, the green sign, came from. The idea there was that all of the tenants within that building came to a single parking lot and a single point of entry and entered the building from that side. So all the tenant identification would have been from that single point of entry.
Off the parking lot.
Off the parking lot.
Okay.
So there wasn't a need for a lot of tenant signs. When Dayton Mailing bought the building, and still falling under a PUD, which is the only way that we could get the building zoned for multi-tenant and industrial. When Dayton Mailing purchased the building, the PUD stayed in place and the multi-tenant stayed in place. And what has changed is now all the tenants are going to basically enter from the outside, wherever those tenants are, because that single point of entry is now Dayton Mailings. So, you know, if you think about that, it, you know, coming into a point and knowing where to go from that point is one thing, because it's internal, and signage isn't a big deal. Mm-hmm. Now, all of a sudden, the tendency is on the outside face of the building. And thus, we've got real problems with people thinking they're going to the same address, but there's three different sides that they could go to. So signage is critical for Dr. Grombeck, especially because he's the furthest away from the other points. And I would make a recommendation that the board consider approving signage for each tenant for their outside exposure of the building. That way, Denise has a guidance that she can go with and says, you know, Dr. Grombeck wants a building sign, he can put one up based on whatever the B2 zoning is for that side sign, and he can put it on the outside and accordingly. So that would be my recommendation.
With that out. So I'd like to invite any other public comment. Dr. Grombeck, I don't know if you had.
Sure.
Yeah. And anything just before we close the public.
Donald Grombeck, tenant of 888 Dayton Street. And one of the interesting pieces is that Google directs you to our parking lot. Mm-hmm. So if you are looking for Dayton Mail Service, you may very well end up in my lobby, as somebody did today who was coming for an interview, because that's where Google says that's the parking lot.
Mm-hmm. And how is that person's blood pressure?
Probably not doing so well, because I think they were running late for their interview. I don't know whether you hired them or not. None of my business. But what I ideally would like is both a sign on the side of the building and one of the signs kind of is, there have been pictures around, and there's one kind of now out there for Dayton Mail Service by the driveway, so that people have something fixed where we right now have our temporary white sign that fortunately the wind has not blown away on us yet, but I'm sure it will soon. Mm-hmm. So that people know where they're going, and you know, particularly something right near where that 888 sign is right now, directing them both for Dayton Mail Service and for community health physicians and all of that, so that people can relatively end up at least where they're intending to,
right, where they're
whether or not
to
they
be.
Should.
I'm right. Not going to touch.
So yeah, that's the challenge. We're just, yeah, we're redirecting at least half a dozen people a day, and you know, a significant number of our people, one of our, you know, several of our patients have showed up 10, 15 minutes late because they end up walking in, you know, who walk in the front doors and keep walking until all of a sudden they get to a door that is locked and can't go anywhere, and are sitting here going, how do I get to the other side? And particularly if it's late in the day, that is right. Not necessarily clear. So we've been trying to figure out how to reach out to people, but that's a little challenging because a lot of our patients are not locals, so yeah. A simple flyer is not a clear and reassuring piece for our patients that are coming from Middletown or Columbus or wherever, as we have a wide variety of. So I think that would be very helpful in decreasing confusion and stress for all parties involved, your employees, mine, and all of the people that are using the building. So.
Great. Thank you very much.
Sure.
So maybe we should clarify the proposal.
Well, I was going to, so by way of doing that, Alice, because I actually also find myself scratching my head in much the same way that Dan is scratching his head. I'm looking in particular at the last, the back page of our packet, maybe this one.
Several different letters.
No.
Right, yeah. You're looking at this thing?
I'm looking at this one. So this is marked with four separate sign locations. And my first clarifying question is, Denise, to what extent does the zoning here govern signs that are, in a sense, internal to the property? And to what extent do they only apply to signage from the street? So I guess I'm looking, for example, at what's marked A here, which would seem to me to be off the street, internal to the property, whereas B and D and C are on street frontage. Do we have to, does the zoning cover all of that, or does it only cover the street frontage?
No, it covers.
It does cover all of that, okay.
Can I interject also on that photo? There's one missing on the,
Dayton Street side where the concrete driveway is, that would be Dr. Grande's, is not on there.
Right.
So we'll call that letter E?
Yes.
Okay, so between D and B?
Yes.
Okay.
And that's mainly because Select Signs is doing this for DNR, so that's why I'm proposing that we increase it beyond that for like Dr. Grande.
Sure. So my next question, and again, apologies if I've misunderstood something here, is the proposal here simply dealing with the number of permitted signs, or does it also deal with the dimensions of signs as permitted under the current zoning?
It doesn't deal with dimensions.
So we're not...
Everybody's fine on dimensions.
Okay.
It's really the fact that you're only allowed to have two types and three total signs.
And so we're asking for...
I mean, currently, there's already a wall sign and three ground signs, but what they're proposing is one of those, two of those in their packet are already existing.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're only changing the face of the sign. And plus the two additional signs there. So we're increasing it by one, but actually we need to increase it beyond that.
Okay.
So, I mean, I heard Ted's formula was an extra sign for each of the tenants. Is that the way, is that your idea, Ted? So that would make it flexible.
Yes.
And that's actually what Planning Commission is proposing. If in the case of a multi-tenant building and needs any either a business or industrial, which is how we're looking at this in this PUD, if they maxed out on the total, then one for each additional tenant beyond that. So we're talking about seven businesses.
So are there? I understand the rationale.
Yeah.
What's an outer limit? I mean, what if this building gets subdivided into 24? Does that mean that what we would pass under that proposal would permit 24 signs?
I mean, no.
You see what I'm asking? Yeah, right.
I hear that. At some point, it would have to become a business center sign, and everything would have to probably
be merged.
Merged together, yes.
So I guess I'm trying to come up with some definition to the proposal that allows what we need to get done tonight, but maybe anticipates something that might happen in the future.
Right.
I guess that's a question too. I'm sorry, I haven't followed the Planning Commission's conversation, but what sort of the implications across the system? And that's, I understand what you guys are talking about, trying to solve some practical problems or issues for your tenants to make sure they have the recognition. But we're also thinking about this, how it impacts the village, and there are a handful of other multi-tenant properties that could presumably come with similar sorts of questions. So I'm wondering, is there a new policy in the works that's going to affect, for instance, Millworks? For instance, probably the two other conspicuous ones are both of the university, Antioch University and Antioch College, both have multi-tenant potentials, even though they don't have it right now. But they have it written into their land use. Is there a proliferation of signs, or is there a limit, as Steve was asking, or how is that defined?
In the case of Antioch University or Antioch College, they would be out of that. They would not be a part of that. This is only for business or industrial.
I think they're both permitted to do a business and industrial in their zoning, for at least...
But they're not zoned that. They're zoned educational. Okay. In the case of Millworks, that would affect Millworks. So, for the most part... right now, I mean, we have a business in there that I had to deny them being able to have a sign, and this would allow them to, once they have a business center sign out in the front, but once you pull into the property, it's hard to find this particular business. And, this is going to allow them as well to.
Yeah, and I see, just in terms of the footprint, there's really one entrance to Millworks, and there are at least three entrances here, which make the signage
different exposure, different context.
How does this, the proposal that has been passed but not accepted yet by the council, does that put a limit on, an outer limit on?
It doesn't put an outer limit on, but it's an interesting question. It might be something that I would talk to council about. Since we're out of the Planning Commission arena now, we're going to council. to look at that possible outer limit. But, I mean, for, we were thinking of places like King's Yard. I mean, a lot of those signs are grandfathered in, but someone could come back and want to do something different.
Well, okay, and just in the interests of keeping us rolling down the tracks here, we can't solve that problem for council tonight, but we do need to address the issue before us with these folks. And so I guess what we need to think about is how to craft a proposal which would allow this to get done, but not necessarily gum up problems, you know, later on.
Right, not set up a tripping point for some other occasion. I did have one other clarifying question, perhaps, and this might be something I've missed again. But it echoes, I think, a question, Steve, that you were asking about, you know, whether there's, clearly there's the issue of multi-entry points, multi-identification of tenants, and clarity that way. The other was with the, I was a little surprised with, I think it's marked sign D, which struck me as larger than was typical in our village, or I thought it was larger at first glance than what is the largest sign permitted?
Well, which one are we talking about?
It's actually a little smaller than
that one right there.
Or excuse me, number A.
Number A?
A.
Yeah, go back and you asked it. No,
right there.
The 4x12, which I didn't think we had.
That one?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. That one would not be allowed in that district, except that it's grandfathered in. And because they only changed the face of it, it's permitted.
And not the dimensions.
The dimensions are outside of what's allowed now. It can't. You can't have a sign that's higher than 6 feet.
Right.
But
it's twice that height.
But it was allowed in 2012. And so because they're only amending the face of it, it's still permitted.
Yeah. And you are aware that is not being seen from any street frontage.
Mm-hmm. That's the internal, interior.
Yeah, it made a lot more sense when it was a mall situation where it multi-tenants.
So maybe it was large to get as many blocks or placards across it as possible.
Ted, you want to?
Yeah, I would say that there is a little bit of latitude here since this is a PUD. You know, you are site specific in terms of its zoning because of the PUD, and you can address your proposal as a PUD exception to grandfathering or doing any other things that might carry on through the building.
Okay. Thank you for that.
And well, I mean, I understand your concern about an outer limit. I'm not sure we really need to be worried about.
Yeah, no, that's fair enough. I don't, and again, I don't want to slow anything up here for purposes of that academic exercise. Just want to make sure we don't pass something we didn't quite need to pass.
Well, so Steve, maybe I wonder if you guys want to, I mean, have the opportunity to frame it around entry points rather than tenants necessarily as well, to have some control over that.
Yeah, that's an interesting proposal. So in a sense, we would be, well, so there are three entry points. And we, four entry points?
There's one on the pad, too.
Is that, am I?
The fifth, the entry on B on your map.
Yeah, on the.
So we really have this one.
You mean entrances off the
street. Sorry?
He means entrances off the street.
Entrances off the street.
Okay, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So does that get us where we need to be? Well, how would we state this? Would we say X number of signs plus an extra sign for each entry point to the building that leads to a business?
Or I wonder if a simpler way is, you know, we have a proposal that has a map that has a number of A through C or four perimeter signs, one internal, just to you know, act on what is proposed in front of us rather than make it formulaic. Because this is anticipating legislation that's not finished by council. So I think it's still in the realm of an exception at this point that we're making. And keep it as simple as possible.
Except that Grunbeck is an additive of letter on track.
Right.
Yeah, that could be added.
Yeah, right, so we've got five, we're looking at five letters here, A through E.
So the five items, we'll act on the five items, wait for the legislation for the rest. We don't have to do this if the legislation's done, right? Again.
Does that meet your needs? We did it that way?
For my own clarification, is it just that it would allow a sign at each of those entry points, or at an entry, like, is there allowance for like a directory sign at the entrance and then a sign on the building directing once you're further in? Because I mean, we've got a fairly sizable drive-through kind of parking lot, got kind of a weird space thing there, and both wanting something that's right near the street sidewalk line and also something that's going to point people in the right direction once they actually park their car. So I don't know if that, I just want to make sure that that's
well,
what I think, what you think.
And again, so this is where we get a little, so if you're talking about a directional sign from the parking lot, that should be exempt.
If it does not have their name on it, it can have their logo, but it can't have their name. And if it's a name, that's why the temporary signs couldn't even fall. I didn't know what category to put the temporary signs in. Because then if it's a nameplate, it has to be on a wall. It can't be in the yard. It's just, I would like to have the flexibility that if Dr. Grombeck came back and decided that he wanted to have a wall sign, that we could put a wall sign. There is no wall sign anywhere on the Dane Street side.
So how would you put that into
right? We want to give you this flexibility.
Yes.
So how do we do it? We just need the language.
I only have one wall plus three grand. So you can see one on this file.
Anything in the world. Yes. Something specific.
The brown sign at each entry point. And at least one additional wall sign. A ground sign at each entry point and at least one additional wall sign.
At each entry point?
So I guess we've got two different kinds of entry points here, right? We've got the entry point off the street and then we've got doors.
Yeah. Right.
So we need to...
And how many entry points do you say you have?
So, okay. Right, so what I'm looking at here suggests that we have three entry points off the street. So this is where I come in on my bicycle.
Mm-hmm. Two on Dane. Mm-hmm. Okay.
But I do not, in fact, know how many doors to the building we are in play here. I mean, as far as we're concerned...
Five doors.
Sorry?
Five entry doors.
Five entry doors.
Is there only that many? Four active, there's six. Thank you, E-Data. Thank you, E-Data. I was going to say, because we have argued with three on our side.
That could be used. One, two,
three. I mean, we could allow as many as seven, because that's the number of tenants occupying the building right now. Seven wall signs.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there could be the distinction wall sign and driveway signs.
Denise, all eyes are on you.
You just go up one on that. That one was a wall sign. So.
So does that from my understanding, that DMS on the door, is that a wall sign?
That DMS sign that's on the
is
a wall sign because of its size.
Okay.
Okay. The other ones do fall within nameplate.
Okay.
And so they're exempt from a permit. Okay.
So question.
Yes.
Tom Cooper with 8 Minute. If we have seven tenants essentially. Well, what we would actually have is seven entry points to their main location. So the question may be that they're wanting that similar to what you see right there for the hospital. They may choose to enlighten that a little bit, to not lighten, but make it bigger, such as also the doctor's office and the other tenants. They have out exterior exposures where they enter into the building. So that might be what we're talking about.
So if you see, the front where the parking lot is, the doctors, he may want that over and above the entryway. That's what I think it is.
All right, we're still reaching for the right language here, right? So we're going to permit three signs. I've lost track.
It's four perimeter signs. Yeah, it's four perimeter signs.
And one wall sign for each tenant.
And a four wall sign.
Up to.
Denise, does that count the corner sign for DMS?
Yes. Well, okay, so again, looking at this aerial.
Looks like you want four perimeter signs.
It looks like we want five perimeter signs.
Yes, right.
Five perimeter signs and one wall sign per tenant.
I wasn't counting the one that was grandfathered in.
Oh, you're not counting the one that's grandfathered, so we're not.
But it's okay, yeah, we'll count that as five.
Okay.
All right.
So five and seven? Five, I mean, are we?
Seven and two.
Okay, so does anybody want to try to?
Well, can I throw something into this?
Sure, is it going to complicate my life?
Absolutely, it complicates things. I'm wondering, given Ted's point about your flexibility within the PUD, if you're able, I'm asking Denise, to amend that logo-only caveat for directional signs to say within this PUD, name is permitted in lieu of logo, because I mean, Dr. Brown would kill a logo, but it, I mean.
Right.
I'm glad that
you're here for my needs.
I mean, if you go generic and say medical office or medical clinic, there's more than one in there, so yes. It doesn't help the situation.
Right.
Yeah.
But if his logo can be Gill Springs Primary Care, that is considered his logo for purposes of PUD, then it solves his directional sign problem.
That would be great if we could do that, yes.
You can.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't see why we can't. Though at this point, right, this is when it's good to be chair, because then I don't have to actually craft this language.
I'm not sure that's part of the rules.
I've seen it. So does anybody want to take a preliminary swing at writing this out so that we actually have something we can go ahead and vote on?
Just going to meet where they meet.
Can I stop you for one second? So do you want to say five perimeter signs, or do you want to say one sign per access point from a main road? Because you might put in another entry point, and then
you're in one other road anyway with the extension.
Yeah. While we're at it, you don't have to come back.
You could make it that generic, and then it covers if they do. Such a thing.
Well, I'm just saying, like, correct me if I'm wrong, but once this gets voted on and then the commission changes theirs, does that override this one?
No.
Well, then let's just say allow up to five ground signs. Leave it at that rather than saying perimeter.
So you want to leave that, okay.
Okay. And up to one wall sign for each business? Does that cover that piece of it?
Mm-hmm.
And then how do we capture Judy's observation? Is it, and the internal directional signs may contain business names?
Names
is that
logos.
Adequate? What?
Names or logos.
Names or logos?
Exempted directional signs.
They contain
the business name or logo.
So can I give this a try?
Yeah.
Okay. So the motion we will at least the motion we're reaching for here is to permit inside this particular PUD. How are PUDs identified, actually?
through Planning Commission.
Now, the number, is it the
888
Dayton Street PUD? Okay, so in the 888 Dayton Street PUD, the motion is to permit 5 ground signs, to permit up to 1 wall sign per tenant.
Per business or per tenant?
Per business slash tenant. And to allow directional signs to contain names in lieu of logo.
I might say exempted directional signs to contain either name or logo.
Okay, to contain either.
Yes.
And probably 1 wall sign for each business is good because one of them is an intent.
Okay, so that's not even yet on the table. How does that resonate with people? Denise, does that seem to work for you?
Great. That would be great. Yes.
That would be great. Yes. Do we feel like this solves your problems? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
What about mine?
Ted, you know what?
Here's a charge per hour.
You're in so deep. Okay, so that's a motion on the table?
Yes.
Do you want to read?
Are you making that motion and shall I repeat it to you?
I'm going to make that motion once Judy repeats it to us.
Okay, so Mr. Kahn is moving to within the 888 Dayton Street PUD to permit up to 5 ground signs and up to 1 wall sign per business slash tenant. And that exempted directional signs within the PUD may contain either names or logos. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, so now we'll have a discussion of this motion. Is there a discussion of this motion?
You need to do your thing.
Yeah, no, I know we're going to, but I guess I want to make sure we have the language right before we go down to the catechism. Are we happy with the language as it stands? Does anything need to be amended or edited or, yeah?
That sounds pretty clear.
Okay.
I think it sounds great.
Okay. So now we will go ahead and, read us the 7 disclaimers or whatever they call these things.
You want me to do that?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So your first variance criteria is whether the property in question will yield a reasonable return or whether there can be any beneficial use of the property without the variance. And then if you want to call through your folks,
sure.
We'll get
okay.
them noted.
Dan?
Yes.
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 Okay. The second is whether the variance is substantial.
England?
Yes.
No.
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 The third is whether the essential character of the neighborhood would be substantially altered or whether adjoining properties would suffer a substantial detriment as a result of the variance.
Then?
No.
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 Okay. The fourth is whether the variance would adversely affect the delivery of governmental services such as water distribution, sanitary sewer collection, electric distribution, stormwater collection, or refuse collection.
No.
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 Okay. Number 5, whether the property owner purchased the property with knowledge of the zoning restriction.
This is what I hate. Go ahead, Dan.
Yes.
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 Number 6, whether the property owner's predicament feasibly can be obviated through some method other than a variance.
Dan?
I'm not sure I really know.
Just take a stab.
I'm going to abstain on that.
No.
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 All right. Number 7, whether the existing conditions from which a variance is being sought were self-created.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, I have no idea.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, I do.
Yes, okay.
I'm going to say no.
Yeah. I'm going to say yes with some... If it's a PUD, it's almost by definition been self-created.
Yes.
All right. Number eight, whether the spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement will be observed and substantial justice done by granting the variance.
Ken?
Yes.
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 All right, so then the board shall determine after weighing the factors described above and any of the factors the board deems relevant, whether the property owner has shown practical difficulties so inequitable as to justify granting a variance to the property owner.
So a vote of yes is a vote in favor of granting the variance, right?
That is correct.
And a vote in favor of the motion that is put on the table.
That's correct.
Yeah, okay.
If you pass B, you are passing your motion.
Right.
Okay.
Caleb?
Yes.
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 Yes. Okay.
The motion is passed.
All right, the motion is passed.
Thank you.
Let there be signs. Is there any new business that we need to attend to?
I have something that I needed to revisit on the minutes of the prior minutes that we already approved. Glancing through the minutes, I made various pithy comments in the meeting, so I must have been at the meeting, but I'm not listed in many people that were at the meeting. So I just add my name.
I was playing you that.
Good heavens.
You're
nice call. There we go.
Okay, so hearing that there is no new business, do I have a motion to adjourn?
So that.
Yeah.
I have a motion to adjourn.
Second.
And that, you know.
Yep, all those in favor?
Happens.
Aye.
Good.
Thanks.
You got it, right?